talent changes before the gate opens, or he's not going to have soul rending. We saw how quickly he died, actually, to Walrix's team when he was running this build with Netherwalk as opposed to soul rending. So Chalky Milkman may see Fusedin as a target. He's going to have significantly lowered self-sustained healing. Ratcher's moving in to secure crowd control. It looks like the Chalky Milkman want to start with an all-in on Burly. Big damage, but no follow-up stun. Clyde wasn't in position. Burly's going to exchange his Earthen Wall Totem, although I'm not sure if he would have liked to use the Earthen Wall Totem for Vendetta and perhaps the Anti-Magic Zone for the Combustion. These cooldowns are now not going to line up. He's going to have to rely on Astral Shift, and Astral Shift doesn't last as long as Vendetta does, so there could be an opening here. They're immediately going to pull the trigger, just using their stuns on cooldown on Burly, this time getting the follow-up, but reversed back by Fusedin. Good counter pressure from the DH DK Nation at this time, with Gelu and Clyde both low on health. The more time that Chalky Milkman spend chasing Burly, the more damage they are going to take in exchange.
A really important part of this game is going to be Gelu on that mage. He's playing Kleptomania to empower his Spellsteal. So when Ratcher gets a kidney shot on Burly, that's when Gelu has to move in. He needs to get the Spellsteal to remove Ghostwolf. And if he's unable to do that, the damage they do is not going to be significant. There it is, the kidney shot into the Spellsteal. But every time this happens, Fusedin has been doing a really good job stunning up Gelu, imprisoning him, slowing down a lot of the damage he's able to put out. But even still, Burly, he has to trade out the Astral Shift. He has to trade out the Spirit Link. Chalky Milkman's been doing a really good job getting a lot of cooldowns, and we haven't even seen Clyde get that aggressive in this matchup. It's mostly just been Ratcher and Gelu who's been able to force out all this pressure.
I'm curious to see if they can kill Burly in the next stun with Hammer of Justice, Kidney Shot, and then vanish into Geralt's Silence. That is a long crowd control chain where Burly won't be able to access Ghost Wolf should Gelu be able to spell steal, which he should be able to as they do engage in attack. Fusedin once again stunning up both damage dealers while Burly is in a stun, allowing him to survive that burst attempt. Even still, with Fusedin's assistance, Burly hovers on very low health. Ratcher's just going to continue the chase at the Shaman. Gelu is now focusing on trying to crowd control the Death Knight and the Demon Hunter using Polymorph, and Frost Nova is here shortly. And as soon as Gelu has control of both the Demon Hunter and the Death Knight, I do imagine that he's going to be wanting to get to Burly as soon as possible. So before dampening DHDK Nation, their main objective should be try to get as much mana out of Clyde and don't let Burly die. Whereas the Chalky Milkmen, their major objective is to just kill Burly as soon as possible before they run out of mana if they keep playing to this strategy.
Ooh, nice.
The strategies could change depending on Gladiator Medallion usage. If Fusedin uses his Gladiator Medallion to assist Burly, he is then a target moving forward for a Smoke Bomb, which line of sights heals, and other spells from your own team. So I'm really interested to see if DHDK Nation, they veer off of the straight and narrow path at all, and if Chalky Milkman look to exploit it. So far, there isn't anything for them to exploit. They have to keep to the main strategy of training Burly.
Yep, Gelu, he tried to get offensive there, but there was a really nice play by Fusedin. He got the Fel Eruption on Gelu. Gelu trinketed out to try to assist, try to take down Burly, but he got immediately put into imprisonment. You can see, once again, Kidney Shot, Fel Eruption on Gelu. And Fusedin's been doing a really good job in this matchup, but it might not matter. Burly gets low, trades out Trinket, Astral Shift, Darkness, and AMZ. DHDK Nation, huge panic mode. This blind setup.
Oh, it's over.
Zap.
It's over.
Burly is so done here.
There is
if he gets zapped
no
again
way.
Into a stun, the game is 100% over. Smoke Bomb gets dropped out. Do they have the damage? If he survives this, it's going to be an absolute miracle. I don't think there's any chance Hammer of Justice
He's
comes in.
To.
Somehow,
what?
He survives? I cannot believe it. That was a perfect setup from Chalky Milkman, and they got denied.
Ratcher got imprisoned during that attack and couldn't commit enough damage to finish Burly off. He was able to get Earthen Wall Totem down, get into Ghost Wolf, and then immediately restabilize.
I'm in disbelief.
I am as well. They're going for another attempt. Burly's in midfield in line of sight of Gelu. He can do a lot of damage here potentially. Fusedin's trying to counter pressure Ratcher off of Burly, but Ratcher doesn't seem to care. He just keeps chasing the Shaman. Ratcher stunned away and finally is forced off. Burly gets out of line of sight, goes for a healing surge. He's a bit afraid of maybe a blink counterspell or Ratcher moving in with a Shadow Step kick. So Burly instead is going to go for the safe play, just go into Ghost Wolf, allow the Spectral Recovery, allow the Pack Spirit to heal himself back up, take no risk with being interrupted when running this Honor Talent and Azerite trait combination, as well as I would imagine the Spirit Wolf, which is another talent. You take those three Ghost Wolf talents and you're almost immortal as a Shaman and Ghost Wolf. Unless the team has a way to remove your Ghost Wolf or catches you in a stun while you're not in it, you are almost guaranteed to not die. Burly, in the meantime, has got a full Hex. Gelu is not dispelling it, taking a really long time to dispel it. And that could have potentially been an ice block. Gelu can't afford to be slow on those D curses. Definitely could be an opportunity for DHDK Nation in the future if he continues.
Yeah, Joel grips Gelu away. Unfortunately, not really able to assist his team right now. And you can tell how badly Gelu wants to get to Burly in these situations. But Joel, Chains of Ice, Death Grip, Imprisonment, Foul Eruption coming in from his team. Burly's had really good backup in this matchup. Without that kind of backup, he would have been Gonzo a long time ago. Gelu is, in fact, playing Gnome as well, so that Escape Artist Racial is going to help him get out of that Chains of Ice and try to make his way over to Burly. But it hasn't been paying off so much. It's basically a game of cat and mouse. In order for Burly to go down, Gelu has to be there to assist. So the entire objective of DK DH Nation is just bring Gelu away, stun him up, imprison him, keep him chained to ice, and Burly just needs to create as much space as possible.
Another attempt here onto Burly. They need the Hammer of Justice. They get it. Reverse magic, though. They Spirit Link Totem. Burly a bit afraid of this attempt, as it is Vendetta. Big damage from Ratcher, potentially. I will say, though, deeper into dampening these hits onto Burly, I feel like there's almost no way that he actually survives. So long as Clyde can have enough mana to keep the team going, I think the Chalky Milkmen are going to take it with this strategy. Ratcher keeps tunneling him down. Gelu looking for polys on Joel. Joel, now, this is a nice move by the Death Knight. So the anti-magic shield is usually a defensive cooldown. You want to use it to stop yourself from taking magic damage, but it also makes you immune to crowd control. So Joel knows he's not the target, so instead of using anti-magic shield defensively, he's using it to avoid crowd control and try to maximize his uptime. Although Burly could be in a bit of trouble here. Triple stun from Fuseton stalls it out. Burly on the run once again in that Ghost Wolf. Gelu trying to crowd control with a double Frost Nova Polymorph cast. Burly, if he dispels these Polymorphs, also has to leave Ghost Wolf, which is why this strategy is effective from the Chalky Milkmen. Either the Demon Hunter or the Death Knight have to sit a full Polymorph, or Burly comes out of Ghost Wolf and potentially dies. Now they're using the Hammer of Justice to cross crowd control, trying to remove darkness as an option in terms of defensive cooldowns. But Joel was ready and waiting with the anti-magic zone, that purple barrier going to allow Burly to easily shake off this attack.
Yeah, earlier on in the game, we saw a bit of a panic mode for DHDK Nation. Burly, he Trinket, Astral Shift, Houston dropped out Darkness, Joel, anti-magic zone. And that's basically, they were so non-committal with their cooldowns that they had to use all of them in order for Burly to survive. And it was a really close call. So what we want to see from DHDK Nation is don't be so afraid, wait long to use those cooldowns. You want to use them a little bit more preemptively on these setups. They're not the longest cooldown, so they will rotate back up. And you can see Burly, he's got Trinket, Astral Shift, Houston still has his Darkness. So just use them during those scary moments when you're still high on hit points. I think that's probably going to be a great solution for DHDK Nation. I think it's something they've improved on in this matchup.
Right, Vendetta pulled here from Ratcher. Burly going to respect that and use his Astral Shift, but dampening's getting pretty high. I'm not sure how much longer this Ghost Wolf build is going to allow Burly to survive. So DHDK Nation need to get some work done here, start getting a lot more mana rifts onto Clyde if they want to close the game out or at least build more pressure. Those aggressive anti-magic shields from Joel are definitely going to be part of allowing them to be aggressive. Potentially they should use reverse magic as well on these Frost Novas instead of using them on Burly to get more uptime. This could be a way for DHDK Nation to just deal more damage and end the game, because at a certain point I think Burly will be overwhelmed. Chalky Milkmen, though, they're mixing it up. They see a different path to victory. Burly with no Trinket is susceptible to Blind Sap. Joel as a Death Knight in Dampening is susceptible to just dying. So Chalky Milkmen take that opportunity to switch targets. A big opening. Darkness is going to fade shortly and Joel's going to fall.
Nice.
Immediate strategy change from Chalky Milkmen. They're following that one strat, but as soon as another one opens...
Gameplay going into game two.
All right. Can DHDK Nation clean up the cooldown usage here against the Chalky Milkmen? Chalky Milkmen saw an opening on the Death Knight, having him use his anti-magic shield aggressively to actually target him right as dampening got high. So to me, DHDK Nation just didn't prepare for that situation, or they were overconfident. Burly, again, going to be the target. They're using Hammer of Justice on the Demon Hunter so that he can't support. So Joel will have to trade, but it's more than fair with the combustion of Gelu to use anti-magic zone. It's more important if Gelu is running the Firestarter build, which I can imagine that he is. He can actually desync the combustion from the anti-magic zone if he gets more fireballs than he is running the Firestarter. So every fireball is 5 extra seconds reduced. There could be maybe a 30-second window where Gelu can go for a kill where there won't be an anti-magic zone on that combustion. That's one of the main win points for Chalky Milkmen. Houston's sitting through a lot of crowd control at the moment. Burly has to make a decision. Does he dispel him and get stunned out of form and then Kleptomania potentially used later on, or does he continue to just run away? It looks looks like running away is going to be the priority here. Fustin using his Gladiator's Medallion to get out of crowd control to deal damage, really, in that position. It wasn't necessary. So now that the Demon Hunter doesn't have a Gladiator's Medallion, they still have Vendetta. They still have Avenging Wrath. They could activate these two powerful cooldowns, catch Fustin in the stun far away from Burly, and use Smoke Bomb to line of sight the Shaman's healing. I'm curious if Chalky Milkmen are going to go for that line of play. It would be something that DHDK Nation may not be expecting.
Yeah, I want you to pay attention to something in this matchup if you guys are watching right now. Watch Gelu and watch Burly. Watch how difficult it is for Gelu to actually get on top of Burly. There's a Shimmer, he gets grip back into an Asphyxiate stun. Now's the Kidney Shot. Burly out of the stun. He's going to be getting out of line of sight as fast as he can. There's big damage actually right now coming in from Chalky Milkmen. Burly has to trade up the Astral Shift, and this is what happened. If Gelu has uptime, they can force out big cooldowns. That's why DHDK Nation, they really have to just force the issue, force Gelu out of line of sight so they can have the opportunity to get in Ghost Wolf, escape, and recover that hit points.
Now, Gelu has Combustion before any Magic Zone for 17 more seconds. If they go immediately on the next stun, they could get Darkness or a kill. Gelu needs to get there, but he gets imprisoned. He actually is going to break out of it, try and get a kill here. Big push. It's going to net them Darkness. That Firestarter build definitely paying off for Gelu. They get the most important defensive cooldown out of the way, and they still have some decent pressure.
Yeah, decent pressure over onto Burly, but that was Gelu's Ice Block. He was sick of being put into prison by Fustin, so he used the Ice Block to get out of it, but unfortunately doesn't have that available for quite some time. But DHDK Nation, they're using a lot of their crowd control on Gelu to stop him from doing damage. Instead of going for a little bit more pressure, putting more crowd control onto Clyde, and actually trying to take down Gelu, they're just trying to live as long as possible. Burly now into a Kidney Shot, into a stun. Hammer of Justice, is he going to be able to escape? Trying to cross the map, he's running for his life right now. And Gelu just so far away with that Death Knight once again. Joel doing an excellent job making it a nightmare for Gelu in the situation. If we look at mana right now, Burly on that Restoration Shaman. Basically, if you're a Restoration Shaman and you're being tunneled down like this, your only healing essentially comes from Ghost Wolf. And that is not a very expensive heal. So at this point in the game, with Burly only healing himself with Ghost Wolf, he's essentially using no mana. Whereas Clyde is going to tax him a little bit more to keep Rasher and Gelu alive through this Demon Hunter Death Knight damage.
Burly was anticipating a stun there, activating the Earthen Wall Totem, but Ratcher held onto the stun, so now he can attack Burly without that defense available. Gelu's trying to make his way over using that Dragon's Breath and then the Escape Artist to get in line of sight, but Fustin was waiting for him around the corner with a stun. Gelu's still trying to get to the Shaman. Burly trying to get as far away as possible. Here comes the stun Vendetta. What cooldowns are they going to trade here? It's a big hit. They do manage to get the reverse magic on the Hammer of Justice, allowing Burly to activate the Astral Shift, but they're going to use any magic zone anyway, as it is Vendetta and Combustion. Two powerful cooldowns from the Mage and the Rogue, respectively, as they continue to push forward, but unlikely before dampening to kill Burly inside of that Ghost Wolf. They're definitely going to be waiting for the Kidney Shot, Hammer of Justice, Silence, Kleptomania, remove the Ghost Wolf, try and 100-0 the Shaman, rinse, repeat, rinse, repeat, rinse, repeat, until it works or until we're deep into dampening, and then the Death Knight and the Demon Hunter become a target for the team of the Chalky Milkmen. Right now, they're going for the all-in. Burly's going to respect it, use the Trinket and Spirit Link Totem, but the Trinket and Spirit Link Totem wasn't during Combustion, it wasn't during Vendetta, it really wasn't during any cooldown, so I would say now Burly is susceptible to that play we saw in Game 1 of being blinded. In the meantime, Gelu being pressured, finally some good damage here from the DHDK Nation. Clyde's going to respect that push, use his Blessing of Sacrifice to stop damage on Gelu, redirected to himself, which is a lot easier to heal considering the Death Knight and the Demon Hunter are nowhere near him. So Clyde will deny that assault with those cooldowns traded. Burly's in the blind. This is the strategy that I was anticipating, but Ratcher is having a difficult time connecting as he is snared and stunned. So he opts to go for Sap out of blind, then connect. Joel pre-anti-magic shields the incoming stun. Joel not using that anti-magic shield aggressively, instead using it to anticipate a swap. They saw that situation in game one, and now in game two, they were more than prepared for it.
Yep, and Joel essentially takes zero damage because of it. That anti-magic shell is going to be really powerful against this particular composition. Chalky Milkmen is running. Clyde down to around 50% mana at this point. Dampening has just kicked in. We're at 3%. Gelu has his combustion rotated back up. He's spamming out a lot of fireballs in this game. We talked about Firestarter, that talent for the Fire Mage. He's able to get that combustion cooldown reduced by 5 seconds every single time he uses a fireball, and that sort of desyncs that offensive cooldown with some of the defensive cooldowns that DHDK Nation has available. Now Burly, he's going to be taking a huge hit, but that was both shimmers from Gelu. He's stuck now. He can't get back to Burly. Burly's going to be crossing the map, and he's going to easily be able to stabilize in this situation. I think Joel of Houston, they're doing a great job defensively so far, but maybe they need to focus more efforts on the Gelu. It seems like they're trying to get Clyde out of mana just by, you know, attacking Gelu, attacking Retro, not really setting up too many kill windows for themselves. All this CC, like I said, is just being put on Gelu. So defensively, they're playing pretty well, but offensively, they're not really setting anything up.
I even think the crowd control could be placed better defensively. They're using it before Burly is stunned. I mean, this is the only time where Burly can die. This is where they need to crowd control either the Rogue or the Mage. Burly's in a lot of trouble, barely holding on with the Gladiator Safeguard Shield procced, absorbing some hits inside of that anti-magic zone, but now Burly has to run. Will Gelu be able to keep up the chase? Unlikely. Ratcher just desperately waiting for Kidney Shot to come off cooldown to go for another attack with that Kleptomania as soon as possible, having Burly as low health as they can before going for the attack, as this is likely to put the most pressure and force more defensive cooldowns or a kill, but Burly is fully recovered. Now anticipating a Kidney Shot, activates the Earthen Wall Totem before it, but Ratcher is going to hold on to it, wait for its defense to fade before engaging with the Kidney Shot. Chalky Milkmen have to 100-0 Burly, at least before dampening. They 100% have to 100-0 him in these stun locks. Ratcher getting gripped into a stun during the stun means that Burly is probably not going to die, so he escapes away, although using his Glider's Medallion. Very important cooldown for the Chalky Milkmen, even though they don't get a kill. Now we see a Hex casted. Gelu needs to decurse that as soon as possible, which he does, and then stabilizes the team immediately. Burly repositioning away from Ratcher and Gelu. We're now at 15% dampening, and I'm trying to see potential for switching targets. It's a bit strange to me that they haven't tried to kill Fuston at any point. He's running that Netherwalk instead of the Soul Rending. He doesn't have that much healing. They could actually potentially at least rot him down a bit by applying some ruptures from the Assassination Rogue and sort of whittle his health potentially and then switch later on. Instead, still just going for the Shaman. Next Kidney Shot could be lethal if they properly cross crowd control the Death Knight and the Demon Hunter. Clyde's getting in position to stun out of the stun. Actually stunning the Demon Hunter.
No.
Big push there. And now Fuston's Glider's Medallion's out of the way. Smoke Bomb still available. Vendetta up in 15 seconds. I would actually like to see a swap to Fuston with the next Kidney Shots and use Blind on Burly. I do believe that they would be able to 100-0 the Demon Hunter, but they're under fire at the moment. Clyde seems to be struggling just to deal with the pressure.
Yeah, at this point in dampening, the Death Knight becomes a very viable target. Fell Eruption over onto Gelu. Ultimate Sacrifice going to be coming in from Clyde at this point in the game. Big damage, actually, on the side of DHDK Nation onto Chalky Milkmen. They're getting bursted down. Ratcher has a Vendetta. It's a very powerful cooldown, like you said. Maybe they want to apply that onto Fuston, but Fuston's kind of prepared for that all, and if he can survive, he has the Netherwalk, like we kind of talked about. Doesn't have as much self-healing, but he will be able to keep himself alive in that really scary situation that Chalky Milkmen can set up. Joel still under fire, and Burly really struggling to keep him alive. Anti-magic zone gets dropped down at the expense of not many cooldowns. I guess it was a Vendetta. Burly's still in crowd control, and then Joel in a lot of trouble. We need to see a Spearling Totem if he can get it. Garrote Silence comes in. Anti-magic shell from Joel will keep him alive. That was nicely done before the Kidney Shot. Now Burly has an opportunity to keep him nice and healthy, dropping down the Spearling Totem. That's going to stabilize his team, and they need to start getting aggressive.
This is going to come down to the wire. I think both teams are in a very high-pressure situation with dampening at critical levels at this point. Joel could fall in any Kidney Shots. Smoke Bomb's also available. If there's a counterspell secured onto Burly from Gelu, I think it's going to be game over for DHDK Nation in game number two here. Gelu doesn't have counterspell, though, for 10 more seconds, but he does have Polymorph catching Burly in crowd control. Joel is isolated. Clyde's in position to get follow-up. They trade Darkness, but the Gladiator's Maledict is absorbing the self-healing from the Death Knight. He's not benefiting too much from the Darkness. Burly's still crowd-controlled, finally out, but there's not much defense. Only Riptide. If he gets counterspelled here, it's going to be game over. Burly has to fake it out. He's trying to just use Riptides, but dampening's too high. Riptide isn't going to be enough. Ratcher and Gelu are both right on top of Burly. He's going to activate the Spirit Walker's Grace, providing him immunity to interrupts, but even with those healing surges, Joel is still low on health. Now caught into another full Polymorph. Fuston jumps over to remove it. Joel on the run, trying to get to safety. Clyde pushing up. Clyde's actually totally out of mana. DHDK Nation, they're limited on cooldowns, but Chalky Milkmen are limited on mana, and because of this, it's still anyone's game. Ratcher being counter-pressured, very low on health, imprisoned on his evasion. Big moves here by DHDK Nation. If they can keep denying the heals just a bit longer. Joel still being pressured. Ascendant's about to fall for Burly. He's caught into a Ring of Frost. Polymorph on Fuston. It's 3-on-1 as a result of Gelu's crowd control. but Joel is still holding on with those death strikes, getting two of them. While Burly is crowd controlled, Gelu gets stunned before he can go for the last polymorph. Clyde not in position to stun, but Joel is just dying to damage right now. Meteor comes crashing in and is going to close it out. Gelu held on to that counterspell the entire match. Ratcher is still being pressured by Fustin. Is he going to go down though? Clyde using the ultimate sacrifice and divine shield. Ratcher takes zero damage effectively, and so does Clyde as a result of that combination of cooldowns. Burly still wants to play it out as the three members of the team are so low on health, but with Avenging Wrath and Divine Favor, if Clyde even gets one Holy Light on this, he's likely to go back to full health. Ratcher's at full health. Burly's in a poly. This game is over. Chalky Milkmen showing that they've got a solid game plan here, and I feel like they could consistently take games off DHDK Nation as they continue playing like this.
Yeah, they didn't even need the DK delete button. Now and will.
Yeah, I mean, things are looking really good here for Chalky Milkman. There was a few close calls. I think when Gelu committed his ice block offensively to break out of crowd control, that should have been a sign for DHDK Nation. They need to play a little bit more aggressive. They're actually going for mana rifts over onto Clyde. That's something we haven't seen too much from Fustin in this matchup so far, and it's looking like they want to play a little bit more aggressive, but they have to be careful. Burly's still a very exposed target. Anti-magic zone's going to trade out for combustion. It's a fair trade, but keep in mind, Gelu, with that fire starter, he can reset his combustion much faster than anti-magic zone's cooldown, and he can get one off without that being an exact lineup, and that's when they can really burst Burly down.
Yeah, and if they're playing more aggressive, it's more likely that they may slip up. Fustin running for mana rifts on the Paladin means that he's going to be separated from Burly, and to be able to use Darkness, you need to be on top of the person that you want to use it on. So separated mana rifting the Paladin in Polymorphs means that Darkness could be taken off of the table. We see Chalky Milkman going for another attack. Burly going to respect it here, use that Glayer's Medallion. It may have not been necessary as Joel assisted him with the Death Grip, but he's just using that Glayer's Medallion to respect the Vendetta, trying to go one for one in terms of that exchange. Gelu finally being pressured. Burly sneaks in a winch here on Clyde's heal, putting Gelu behind. Avenging Wrath pop for Clyde. He's imprisoned on it. If they can get a cauterize during the Avenging Wrath, that's a big deal. They at least get a Blessing of Sacrifice due to the extra crowd control chain that DHDK Nation initiated, which is one extra cooldown that they wouldn't have got otherwise, so well done. Clyde's moving in, looking for the stun out of stun on Burly, but Fustin's there to back him up with a triple. Will it be enough to keep Burly alive? Triple Dragon's Breath. There's no Garrot Silence. Ratcher's holding on to the Vanish. Maybe he wants to pair that up with a stronger cooldown push, potentially the Combustion on the next attack. Chalky Milkmen, I would say aggressively, are playing still to the same level as they have the entire series, but due to Fustin running that Mana Rift talent this time around, their clock is a lot shorter.
I think it's a really intelligent decision by DHDK. In the last two games, they were kind of just playing to live, and sometimes that makes you win, but it definitely wasn't in this case. Chalky Milkmen, they were able to exploit the fact that Joel, on that Death Knight, his self-healing is reduced by so much that deep into dampening. If they could just get to that point, they win. And there was not that much pressure coming in from DHDK Nation. So I think here in game three, backs against the wall, go more aggressive. And that's exactly what they're doing. Clyde already around 50% mana. If Fustin can continuously land these mana rifts, Chalky Milkman, they're not going to have that same sort of time frame we saw in game one and two.
All right, let's see if the Chalky Milkman can close this game out faster. If not, DHDK Nation may reverse sweep this three in a row with this aggressive strategy, or at least force the Chalky Milkman to change healers, because the Paladin is not going to be able to drink without access to stealth like a Druid. Although if they do run the Druid Rogue Mage, they've got the biggest maps in the pools to play on. So they've at least got that going for them if they want to play it out for the rest of the series, because so far this strategy is working a lot better for DHDK Nation. I honestly don't know why you would ever play Demon Hunter Death Knight without Mana Rift. I feel like that is the main reason why this composition can even win games, is it lacks a Mortal Strike. Its damage is pretty lackluster before dampening. The only way that you actually run teams out of mana is by running the moon with Mana Rift. So I would say it was maybe a bit of a mistake by DHDK Nation to not be running that talent up until this game, where they're now on match point. Joel sitting in a Frost Nova. Perhaps Joel should even be running the gnome, get the escape artist to get out of more Frost Novas. Clyde's trying to push forward with the team to get a Hammer of Justice on Burly, but Gelu, he's waiting for Gelu. He's going to use Blessing of Freedom on Gelu. That allows Gelu to freely move across the battlefield, get right on top of Burly. Spellsteal that Ghost Wolf. This is the all-in. We likely see a Vanish. This could be the end of the game if they're not careful. They're going to trade the Anti-Magic Zone and the Spirit Link Totem. Even still, taking quite a big hit there. That was the all-in by Chalky Milkman. They don't get the kill. They get denied, but they've opened up opportunities for a swap to the Death Knight. But without dampening, I'm not sure if the Chalky Milkman are even going to take that opportunity right now. They may just continue training the Shaman, focusing on crowd control on the Death Knight and the Demon Hunter until later into the match. But how much later? Clyde's almost already out of mana.
Yeah, I mean, Clyde's not doing well. He's around 20% mana at this point. Houston seems to be moving forward, trying to back up early just a little bit. Gelu looking for some crowd control. And I actually, Gelu trinketed out of an asphyxiate stun around 20 seconds ago, but I don't think it was necessarily the best time to use his trinket. He needs to have that available when they go for those offensive pushes onto Burly. That's when he needs to have damage available. Combustion's going to be traded out. Big damage coming in from Gelu. A huge meteor. 3v1 situation. Fusion and Joel were just Nova far away. Nicely done by Gelu. Can Burly survive? Astral Shift gets traded out. He's in Ghost Wolf. He's trying to run away. Another full blind coming
it's
in
out
from
of
Ratcher.
Ghost Wolf.
What is he going to be able to do? If he can land the sap, it's going to be massive. Fusion trying to deny it. Bell Eruption. Nicely done. Fusion stopping Ratcher from getting that re-stealth. And that sap is what kept Burly alive.
All right, nice play by Fustin there, but now he needs to worry about getting aggressive again. He's got a mana rift Clyde out so that they can get some pressure going. Joel has been sitting a lot of crowd control at the moment. I'm wondering if he is going to use that anti-magic shield aggressive at some point, and if Chalky Milkman look to punish it. I feel like before dampening, Joel can definitely use the anti-magic shield however he pleases. And then in dampening, that's when he should start considering the situation. Does Burly have a Glider's Medallion? Do they have Darkness? If not, then probably hold on to it until a later time to survive. Imprison on Ratcher while Burly is stunned. There was no spell steal as Gelu is stunned as well, so Burly takes no damage on that attack. Easy trade for DHDK Nation. Now they'll have cooldowns for Vendetta, which is available on the next stun. Clyde is basically out of mana, and I mean, every other game without Mana Rift was, I would say, at maybe 50 or 60% at this point, so there's a significant lead for the DHDK Nation. Chalky Milkman might be in trouble here. Gelu taking some big hits from Joel, finally getting some counter pressure here on Dalaran Sewers, interrupting Clyde on his heel into a stun, putting him behind. This could be the Cauterize the Ice Block.
Ice Block.
Once again, good crowd control onto the Paladin, denying his healing. That's them Avenging Wrath and Ice Block. DHDK Nation are playing a solid game this time around, and I mean, the difference of just running one different talent means the entire game. This situation was not even remotely close in the first two games, but switching to that Mana Rift and suddenly DHDK Nation are in the driver's seat.
Yeah, but look at this. Clyde is positioned across the entire map. If he's sitting down for a drink, Fusen wasted the last 5 minutes of this game, but luckily he's able to dash over in just a second and stop Clyde from recovering any of that mana. Gelu now in a little bit of trouble. Keep in mind he's got no Ice Block. He's playing the Fire Mage, so he has the Cauterize still available, but there's no Ice Block. Clyde actually traded out his Ultimate Sacrifice as well, so he really doesn't have much mana to work with. Using the Ultimate Sacrifice is sort of a preemptive measure, but this is looking really good for DHDK Nation.
All right, DHDK Nation looking like they may be able to at least put one game on the board here in the lower bracket. It's an elimination match, best of five. Loser of this goes home in fourth place. Chalky Milkman can't afford that. They have an opportunity here to get into the top four because of a poor performance on Wildcard Gaming parts, or Wildcard Gaming's part, and Change My Mind. Zyzon and Chalky Milkman have the most to benefit in this tournament due to the lack of performance from those two teams. So Chalky Milkman, they've worked so hard to get to match point, but DHDK Nation, they just change one talent and suddenly this matchup looks exactly as Zico predicted, completely in their favor. So playing this out for another two games, I feel like Chalky Milkman need to make some adaptations. They have made it into a somewhat deeper stage of dampening, so the Death Knight likely is going to become their target here unless they can get the trinket from Burly. They do manage to with blind. So now they have two lines. Do they keep crowd controlling Burly and kill the Death Knight, or do they swap? But they're running out of time to go down that line. Gelu taking huge damage. Cauterize is triggered. He's on the run, but Clyde gets interrupted. DHDK Nation, their crowd control was much more on point. Defensive rotation was perfect. And
for Chalky Milkman, as they look to put the final point on the scoreboard and knock DHDK Nation out of the tournament, it's Mystic on the Retribution Paladin. I can't wait to see what happens next.
The problem with this composition is they have no way to remove Ghost Wolf. So Burly, if they even target Burly, I feel like it's a mistake. And it looks like they want to do it, but Burly's just in Ghost Wolf too far away, so they're going to go back. Now, deeper into dampening with Grapple Weapon and the huge amount of burst damage that the Rep Paladin brings, I do see the Death Knight going down. That should be the main priority, in my opinion, of the Chalky Milkman, is make it to the 20 to 40% dampening mark, try and burst down Joel on the Death Knight. use the Blessing of Wisdom and the multiple disease dispels to reduce the amount of damage you're taking and increase the amount of mana regeneration that you have. And if you can make it to Dampening or maybe even kill the Death Knight before Dampening, depending on how much pressure these classes do together, we don't usually ever see a Retribution Paladin and a Windwalker paired up. This is the first time that we're going to see it. Perhaps they can kill the Death Knight faster than that, but I feel like the Death Knight should be the priority target for them overall. Maybe slow down the Demon Hunter, even split before Dampening, have the Windwalker just sit on the Demon Hunter, make it annoying for him to land mana rifts, and then this way you're not stacked up, you're not both taking maximum damage. At the moment, double leg sweep, Hammer of Justice, good crowd control attempt by the Chalky Milkman. Joel taking a beating here, he's tapped on Runic Power now, so Death Strikes are going to be limited, they're pushing forward. I mean, the other limitation is that there are effectively no ranged interrupts for the team of the Chalky Milkman, so Burly will get healing wave after healing wave for free outside of those Hammer of Justice windows. Clyde getting gripped into a stun and a mana rift. We see the Earth Elemental from Burly. That's going to be chasing Clyde around the corner, punching him and keeping him in combat, stopping him from drinking. That is the priority for DHDK Nation once again. Get the Druid out of mana and kill the team before Joel is a target at 20 to 30% dampening.
Yeah, Joel's going to be taking a little bit of damage. It's up to him and Burly to survive. Clyde with the drive-by bash. Houston now looking for a mana rift, unable to find it, unfortunately. The Blessing of Sanctuary coming in clutch for Mystic a few times in this game. You can see under Mystic's nameplate, it's a 45-second cooldown. Whenever that's up, he can use that ability to get Clyde out of a stun, and that's going to free him up from those incoming mana rifts that Houston has. And over the course of a game, with Blessing of Wisdom, that's going to allow Clyde to recover a lot of his mana and avoid those mana rifts, which are really important for DHDK Nation to find in this matchup if they want to get him out of mana. But even still, Clyde is still behind on mana. They're landing the mana rifts, and at this point, I really don't know if Clyde's ever going to be able to drink. I'm not 100% sold on this composition yet.
I'm not sold on it either. I think overall, the map, it makes sense on paper what they want to do, but does it actually work is the question, right? I mean, you can theory craft a composition all you want until you're blue in the face, but when it actually comes to executing it out, if you also don't have practice on it, I mean, this could be a case where they've just pulled this out because it works on paper with no prior preparation. They're trying to attack Houston, who is a bit overextended, but for dampening, not really going to be denting him too much. Ring of Peace is stopping Houston from getting to Clyde. Burly's trying to wrap around and get him, but he's in stealth. Houston has Shadow Sight, though. He can see stealth targets. Clyde needs to get away from the Demon Hunter as soon as possible. They need to stop Houston from finding him. Looks like they stopped him for now. Houston's guessing where he is pretty effectively. Clyde's position now, I believe, in the far corner. Ratcher is going to have to trade Touch of Karma for mana. I think that's more than a fair trade. We're not even close to dampening. I do think a full mana bar is worth it. Looks like if they can get away without doing it, it would be fair enough. Mana now even here. Still some potential. I do think around the 20-30% dampening mark that the Red Paladin and the Windwalker are going to start stinging a bit on this Death Knight. Just a matter of making it to that point.
Well, Clyde was able to recover a lot of his mana, so that's huge for Chalky Milkman, and it really speaks volumes to me. I mean, Chalky Milkman with the Rogue Mage Paladin, they're up 2-1 in this series. They were just one game away from winning, but that adaptation from DHDK Nation must have thrown them for a loop, and now they're going to be relying on this Retribution Paladin, at least in game number 4, on this large map. And I think this large map is good for multiple reasons. I think one of the reasons it's good is large pillars for Clyde to try to kite around to avoid Futin mana rifts as much as possible in this matchup. So on Tolvaron, there's basically two main advantages. It's a very wide open, so that's when, you know, a wizard cleave such as Mage Lock Druid would really be advantageous because you can pull your opponents into the open. The other advantage of this map is there's large pillars that you can get behind and kite around. Mystic getting bursted down. He already had to use his Divine Shield, so that was a big victory for DHDK Nation. That's a long cooldown Mystic's no longer going to have available. They overlapped it with Iron Bark, so DHDK Nation really bringing the heat.
I actually think Clyde is making a mistake running Guardian Affinity. I feel like in this matchup, especially with the classes he has on his team, a Windwalker and a Rep Paladin are never going to let you die. I feel like that's almost certainly not going to be the win condition. Feral Affinity would just let him move around the map faster. He'd be able to do the re-stealth stun cyclones on the Demon Hunter, get away, and be able to drink. The Feral Affinity is just better suited for that. Clyde is trying to go for the ultimate survival build by running the Guardian Affinity, but I'm not sold on it being the best option. Also running the Thorns. I mean, it makes sense you want to be running Thorns. There's two melee attackers on the opposing team, but it's two melee attackers that really don't care about Thorns. They're going to heal themselves through it. So maybe use Thorns, but don't press it until deep into Dampening, because it's an expensive spell. Whereas in deep into Dampening, when the healing is reduced, it may actually have some effectiveness. So Clyde should be managing those Thorns later into the match. Chalky Milkman at this point, having experimented with their crowd control and their burst, probably already have found out this Death Knight isn't going to be going down before much deeper into Dampening. So start conserving mana, start playing for the late game, try to go for that all in, close the series out 3-1 and advance in the lower bracket. If they can play conservatively, make it to that point. Certainly, I think this composition has the capability. The only thing that they're really lacking, and I already pointed out, is ranged interrupts. So deep in Dampening, normally the Shaman would struggle because he has to cast heals to save his Death Knight, but there's no interrupts to stop those casted heals, so it's actually not that hard for the Shaman to heal through the pressure in this specific matchup. He's going to need to be crowd controlled. Something like a Hammer of Justice, which Mystic is already engaging with, then a Paralysis, and maybe even a Cyclone, but Clyde is actually not even running the Cyclone on her talent, so there are not going to be any Cyclones or extra crowd control. The other downside here for Chalky Milkman is that the Rep Paladin self-healing gets reduced, as well as the Windwalkers over time. So it's not only the Death Knight that becomes more vulnerable. The Rep Paladin and the Windwalker do as well, increasingly. Mana still in favor of Burly and DHDK Nation. I would still say that the game is in their favor at the moment, unless Clyde is able to find a drink.
Yeah, this is going to be one of those moments where if Chalky Milkman win this game, we're going to be calling them geniuses. And if they lose this game, we're going to be saying they absolutely threw. And I feel like Ratcher revealing that he can play Windwalker Monk leaves Chalky Milkman with lots of solid options. I mean, we know Gelu plays the Frostmage. Frostmage Windwalker Restoration Druid is a great matchup into what DHDK Nation has available. So that might have been a better option for them, but we'll have to see. Chalky Milkman can pull this off. They will be winning this series, like we kind of mentioned. Joel on that Death Knight is going to be very vulnerable to the damage Mystic and Ratcher can put out, especially when he's not able to Deathstrike himself as much. Dampening is just a huge nuisance, basically, to what DHDK Nation has. The Restoration Shaman, later on in Dampening, his healing isn't that great. Neither is the Death Knight's going to be, and that's when Mystic and Ratcher can really start putting in work.
What do you think of the honor talent for Ratcher running Alpha Tiger instead of something like Grapple Weapon? Do you think it's a big deal? I feel like it's a pretty big deal to be dropping the Grapple Weapon when you're fighting two melee classes that rely on attacking to heal, whereas the Alpha Tiger, like, it's a minor increase in damage, but you could just completely remove the mechanic that's stopping you from killing the target with Grapple Weapon.
Yeah, so the thing about Alpha Tiger that's really good, especially when you're on Unholy Death Knight, is you have high uptime with it. You can use your jab on to the ghouls. So you can use it on the ghouls, you can use it on Fustin, you can use it on Burly, you can use it on a totem. And in this particular matchup, Ratcher's going to have really high uptime of the Alpha Tiger, which is essentially a Bloodlust for Windwalker Monk. So it is a lot of damage. I kind of agree that Grapple Weapon might be better. What are the other talents that he's running?
Turbo Fist, Expel Harm, or Reverse Harm. I feel like you need those two.
Those two are 100% mandatory. I don't mind the Alpha Tiger, but I do think Grapple Weapon might actually have a little bit more value in this matchup.
Or maybe even Clyde playing a different healer instead of the Druid. Maybe a Mistweaver, a Double Monk, something like that, doing all in. I'm not sure. I'm trying to make this composition better than the Chalky Milkmen have crafted it to be here in this specific matchup. They're really on the ropes here. They've gotten deep enough into Dampening where the Death Knight is now a target, but Clyde is out of mana, so he can't use Thorns. He can't really do much at this point. They're going to jump in for crowd control. They're going to try and go for the kill. Touch of Death, Avenging Wrath. This is the big hit. This is where they could use Grapple Weapon, and Joel wouldn't be able to Deathstrike. They do manage to get Spirit Link regardless, as well as the Lichborn, so Joel is going for that Honor talent, which turns his Icebound Fortitude into a one-minute cooldown, down from 3 minutes, which means he can more frequently use it, rotate it up with other cooldowns on the team. I think that was a smart decision on Joel's part, as this team is much more burst-oriented, although deeper into Dampening, the sustained damage becomes more relevant. That was a big attack, though, from the Chalky Milkman. They're showing that they have capabilities of closing this out. Clyde got mana back. This is good signs for the Chalky Milkman.
I honestly feel like Joel's just going to die. I feel like they have a lot of overwhelming damage. You know, if Mystic and Ratcher have any offensive cooldowns coming back up, I can see Joel falling, but it's Mystic that could be in some trouble. Ironbark, once again, overlapped with the Divine Shield, and that's a really big deal. But unfortunately for DHDK Nation, that was the Earthen Wall Totem. There's no Spirit Link. Joel really has no catch-up mechanics. If they go all in with burst damage right now, Chalky Milkman could easily close out the game.
I mean, it's anyone's game at this point. The cooldowns are so limited. Fustin stunned. He can't use Darkness for one more second. Big hit there from Mystic. Darkness gets traded. Joel should be... Oh, Ring of Peace is the Darkness. Joel is able to get into it, though. He saved Death's Advance, so he's immune to knockback effects to get into that Darkness and stay alive. That was good awareness on his part to hold onto that cooldown, realizing that would be a counter to the darkness and then answering it. Now, potentially, they have the momentum. There's still a Blessing of Protection, though. Mystic can activate that. And with the double dispel on the diseases, they can also reduce the damage significantly onto Mystic. Burly's trying to pick up Joel, but dampening's pretty high. Next crowd control could close the game out. Clyde gets gripped into a triple stun. Mystic's low on health.
Oh,
he needs
no.
to use that Blessing of Protection soon. He is going to use it. And with Ironbark, I think he's going to stabilize. This is where you'd want to use Thorns to counter pressure the Death Knight away from a target that has limited defense in this position, and that's actually Ratcher. Burly in a stun, but Fustin ducks over, reverses him out of it. Now Ratcher's low on health, although I don't think going after the Windwalker is the move. I think you switch right back to the Rep Paladin.
This is
Avenging
gonna be
Wrath, Touch of Death available. This is what Chalky Milkmen were playing for. 40% dampening plus all of their cooldowns. There should be absolutely no way that Joel makes it out of life through this damage.
No way.
It's the most amount of damage they can do in the game. The highest point of dampening that they really need to get a kill. Touch of Death explodes, but Ratcher is still being counter-pressured. He has Karma, though. Karma immediately redirecting the damage to Joel. He has to run. His Shaman's in crowd control, but running is not going to be able to allow him to survive.
Goodbye,
alone.
Joel.
Huge damage. Again, if there was grapple weapon, Joel wouldn't be able to use Death Strike. He would just be dead right now. He's going to die anyway to the pressure. The composition works out. Mystic carrying through with that Retribution Paladin.
It finally worked for him.
Yep, exactly. Mystic.
Feed versus the fake Zebras. We're all tied up. 1-1. Who is going to find themselves on match point? Who is going to get a little bit further into this tournament? Keep in mind, folks, we're doing a brand new thing. You have just entered, in the middle of history, the longest series that has ever been played in Battle for Azeroth.